This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we're going to be talking to someone very controversial, Anjali Schultz. I've been mispronouncing her name for almost the entire time I've known her. And you'll hear me mispronouncing it on the show as Anjali. And so I'm apologizing in advance. I'm making this video introduction after we did the show. And so her name is Anjali Schultz. She is a very unusual person in the sense that she has had a distinguished career in the intelligence service and wound up on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial announcing that she was going to lead a team of scientists into a cave in the Mojave Desert on December the 21st, 2021, in order to meet aliens. As soon as I heard that, I knew two things. First, it probably isn't going to happen. And second, I understood very well the reason she might have been, I won't say tricked into, but asked to do that in such a way that she didn't feel any ability to refuse. This show will be unlike anything else you have heard or seen with Anjali. Very different, because I have a very different perspective on all of this than people outside of the experience. I am an active close encounter experiencer engaged right now in the experience in my life. And I bring that perspective to this conversation with Anjali Schultz. Today we're talking to Anjali Schultz, who has made a certain amount of, certain number of waves in the UFO world recently, and we're going to be talking about that, but from a different perspective, because most of the people who have interviewed Anjali are not experiencers. They haven't had this in their lives. What happened basically was that Anjali, after a distinguished career in the intelligence community, suddenly ended up on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial announcing that she would lead a group of scientists into a cave in the Mojave Desert on December the 21st, 2021, where they would meet face-to-face physically with aliens. And it didn't happen. Now, that would seem to be, well, let's just dismiss her. She made a prediction and it's not true. I have no intention of dismissing her. I have been trying for 30 years to make this thing work out in some way that it becomes physical, and it didn't, and it never has, not really. I'm close, and we're all close. A lot of us are close. But I want to find out more about what motivated Anjali and what her expectations for the future are and what she wants to do. So Anjali Schultz, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you so much, Whitley. First, I just want to tell you what a pleasure it is to be here with you today and how grateful I am for your time and your perspective on this experience that's still ongoing in my life. If you would have told young teenage me that we would be having this conversation now, I wouldn't have believed it. I read your book when I was very young, and it had quite a familiarity to me that I couldn't quite put my finger on at the time. But I think that today I'm getting closer to that as well. But thank you. Thank you for having me.
Well, it's a real pleasure. And, you know, you're as controversial a figure as shows up right now in the UFO world. Anjali and I had a conversation on Zoom about 6 weeks ago, or a little longer. And during that conversation, we exchanged some material about good and evil, right and wrong. And Anjali asked me a question which I regard as the most important question that can be asked about those subjects. And I was very surprised to hear that, because mostly you never hear it except from the visitors. And we're going to get into that later. But I'm teasing you now, I know that. And I'm doing it on purpose because I want you to stay with us. A lot of people have already got opinions about Anjali Schultz. I do not have an opinion at all. I am very interested, though. Where I would like to start is with your life in the intelligence community, which is a very distinguished career in that community, and then circle back to your experiential life and why you read Communion. But let's first start about what you did specifically. You were in the Air Force, and then you had to leave the Air Force for health reasons. And then you end up in the intelligence community. How did that all happen?
I'm not sure exactly how I ended up in the intelligence community, except to say that I felt a call to service. And at the time, I was in, I was finishing my second undergraduate degree, and I was trying to determine my way forward. And I had two children, and I was single at the time. I'd been divorced. And so I was trying to plan for all of our futures, the three of us. And one of the things that I was considering at the time was Luther Seminary. I delved deeply into that consideration. I also took the Foreign Service exam and was interviewed in Washington, D.C. and in Fort Lauderdale a couple of times, and interviewed with the FBI and interviewed for a graduate assistantship to go to graduate school. So all of these things were like plan A, B, C, D. How do I go forward? Well, time was running out. You know, summers are short. And I ended up at grad school. And right after I began the semester, I got a call on my cell phone from DIA, and they offered me a position as an intelligence officer. There was no interview that about, you know, what kind of work I wanted to do or what I could bring to the table. This was an offer that was being made to me directly. I just needed to pass my very extensive background security check. So that began. And the next thing I knew, I spent a few semesters at grad school and then moved out to Washington, D.C. and ended up working in the Human Factors Analysis Center. And that's where we were looking at state and non-state leaders and how the United States could appropriately, through more diplomatic channels, influence decision-making so that we could have peaceful resolutions that would, of course, be in the best interest of the United States. And so it was essentially personality profiling, and I was successful at that. I had an amazing mentor who actually began the department. And if you ever see this, I miss you. And you were amazing. Thank you for everything that you taught me. So from there, I worked on a couple of other projects and that were also successful, and ended up in a short period of time working at the Pentagon. So not sure exactly where you want me to go from there, but it was quite an experience, and it was a quick rise. I hadn't been with the agency very long when I was recruited to the Pentagon position. At the time, it was called the Executive Support Office, and it was just a very quick rise, and I was the youngest woman that was in the division, one of only a few, and most of them had been in the intelligence community. They were seniors, and they had been there for many years, and they were serving there. So it was quite something for me. I felt very honored to be among such distinguished and accomplished women who were working behind the scenes, you know, for diplomacy. So it was,
well, I can, yeah. And it's a very interesting area of the Defense Intelligence Agency because of the depth you go into analyzing the psychological makeup of foreign leaders of various, not just presidents and premiers, but deep down, deeper into the governments to try to understand who these people are, as mm-hmm. so that when our forward-facing elements, such as everyone from the president to senators and so forth, they can receive yes. briefings before they speak to these people that are
That's
useful.
Right.
So it's That's a terribly right. important job.
It is. It is. And it arose from the dust of 9/11 and going into Afghanistan and Iraq, and a need for a better understanding of the other leaders and non-state actors, you know, such as Taliban leaders, which we did not consider state actors at that time. They had been overthrown. So it's definitely, you know, a very essential part of, I think, what the Defense Department does with respect to keeping peace in the world. And that's not very well known, you know. People tend to think of the Pentagon as a war machine. Everything that I worked with, that I had touch points with, were actually efforts for peace and diplomacy, for other means of resolution and support of nations that had fallen or that needed uplifting after their own, you know, internal kinds of devastation. So I'm very grateful for that experience, and it was a natural fit for me. But, you know, like I said, the founder of that division, who created that methodology, she's just absolutely brilliant. And I'm very grateful to have worked with her. So,
so
anyway,
now you leave this service, I believe, for reasons of illness again. Is that correct?
I left. Now, when I was in the Air Force, I actually worked in orthopedic surgery. So that was a completely different field. And I left after I had a second pregnancy that was considered high risk, and I was going to need to be on bed rest. And I already had a child who was, at the time, he was just a little over a year old when I found out that I was pregnant again. And so my body hadn't healed enough from the first pregnancy, and we didn't know at the time that I had a connective tissue disorder. And so I was having a very difficult time with my second pregnancy. And so I sought and was given an honorable discharge due to high-risk pregnancy.
Yeah, well, that certainly makes sense. You can't successfully pursue an Air Force career with a situation like that.
That's right.
Now, you've had an interest in politics. I believe you ran for, is it Secretary of State of South Dakota at one point?
I did. And that, I have to tell you, I felt more like a sacrificial lamb than I did a politician. It was, again, I always feel, I've always felt a need to serve, and most of everything I've done in my life has been some sort of service to others. And if you think about it, that's how most of us live our lives on a daily basis. If we can step outside of our own perspective of what we're doing and see it from the greater connection to all, we tend to serve each other on a daily basis. And so when I was asked if I would consider running for a statewide seat, I was hesitant. I knew that there wasn't a chance in God's green earth that that was going to happen, that I could be successful here. And so I had an ethical dilemma. And the dilemma was that once I said yes, that I would accept this and pursue a nomination and go through the whole process of losing, I said, well, you know, they wanted me to fundraise and ask people to donate to me, to tell them, you know, about how we were going to win and how, you know, they were going to make a difference with this. With this donation. And it didn't seem right to me, Whitley. They wanted me to play a game that was immoral. And so I quickly fell out of favor
if you don't fundraise in politics, you're gonna fall out of favor. Toot sweet.
Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
And with the leaders of the party. They were quite upset with me. And so, you know, found I was not cooperative in the way that they wanted. So what I did instead was I went town to town as much as I could. And I just talked to people. And I didn't ask for donations. If they offered them, that I would accept them. All in all, I only raised $11,000. Enough to be able to do what I needed to be able to do without building some kind of big coffer like we were winning, you know?
Yeah.
I spent every single dime of it on advertising and travel and had the most, you know, per capita, per dollar for dollar, like the most successful election that they'd seen of a newcomer. They couldn't believe it. I lost miserably, you know, something like 83,000 to, I think she had like 130,000, but my opponent also spent over $150,000.
Yeah. And well, you could say this, 83,000 South Dakotans couldn't be wrong, right? I remember when Barry Goldwater ran against Lyndon Johnson, they were saying 50 million Americans couldn't be wrong, which implied that 150 million could be.
That's right.
I had a long period of time in my life in politics, and I finally decided, my family was very, very involved in Texas politics, and I decided it's just not for me, and I moved to New York, and I never looked back. I became a writer. Oh. Now, you have wanted to become a writer, too, and you have a book, you've struggled with this. There have been agent rejections and the usual miseries of trying to become a writer. How do you feel about that now?
I don't have a feeling associated with it. I would say that I was working full time. I was going through a divorce as this novel was coming out, this first novel. My husband and I had separated. I was splitting time with my son, and I was also ill. You know, and now looking back on my life, I see all the subtleties of chronic illness that I wasn't aware of then. You know, I kept having these, what I thought were these acute, sudden illnesses that we couldn't figure out, like rhabdomyolysis. You know, nobody has acute onset idiopathic rhabdomyolysis. Basically, that means it came out of nowhere. We don't know how it happened. And suddenly her tissue or her muscles are like she just ran a marathon or received a crush injury.
Well, we're free Dreamlanders. We're going to take a little break, which I forgot to take at 15 minutes. I was interested in this life story that we're listening to. And when we get back, we'll gradually move a little deeper into a cave in the Mojave Desert and how we got there. It seems that in-person conferences are finally coming back. I'm going to be at the Conscious Life Expo February 4th through 7th at the LAX Hilton near Los Angeles Airport. It's going to be quite a conference. I'm going to be talking about my new book, about them, a deep look into just who our visitors are through the medium of what they do. It's going to be a very interesting talk, I can assure you. A lot of friends are going to be there. Jacques Vallée is going to be there. Jimmy Church is going to be there. George Noory is going to be there. It's quite a big group. Bashar will be there. I haven't seen Bashar in a long time. William Henry, Linda Moulton Howe will be there. All kinds of great people. Adam Apollo is going to be there. Alan Steinfeld will be there. All kinds. It's just a wonderful lineup of extraordinary people. So go to ConsciousLifeExpo.com and you'll be there too. We'll see you at the expo. I can't believe after all this time, I am finally able to say those words. Anjali, where can people go to find you on the internet?
The best place to find me would be on Twitter, at Anjali on Gaia. And no, I'm not associated with the TV network in any sort of way. It's just the name I chose for where we are. At Anjali on Gaia on Twitter. And we are also in the process of completing our website reboot, transcensionproject.com. It is not live yet, but we hope it will be soon.
Okay. So I guess the best place to do is to go is to your Twitter feed. And Anjali is very active on Twitter. So if you do become a follower, you'll see a lot from her for sure. Now, let's go back to early life. You mentioned at the outset that you read my book Communion when you were a young girl, and unfortunately probably younger than I would like to think. But in any case, you read my book then, and but there would have been a reason that you picked that book up. Can you tell us what that reason was? Why did you pick up Communion?
One of my earliest memories is of a craft that was over our home one night. For years, I didn't know if I was 3 or 4 years old, but I always remembered being on our couch, looking out the window at my mother and everyone else in the neighborhood, like standing out in their yards and in our driveway at one point. Like the neighbors had walked over and we're all standing in our driveway looking at this amazing craft that was hovering above our home. For years, my mother and I talked about it, and that's all either one of us remembered. There were other people who lived in the house who also remembered that my mother was still in contact with. And so it was this, you know, fascinating event.
What exactly did the craft look like?
Oh, sure. I'm so sorry. No. Okay. So for years, all I could remember was that it was cylindrical, and circular, and it had various colored lights that would rotate around it, around the bottom edge, and there was a light that was coming out from beneath it. And I remember this specifically because it was shining down everything that I could see when I was looking out the window it looked like daylight, except around the edges you could tell. And I knew it was night. I knew it was night because in the hallway that I had run down to jump up on the couch and look out the window, it was dark and it was night. So it was metallic. It was large. It was larger than our house. And it hovered there for some time that none of us could calculate. My mother and I talked about this for years. We always remembered it. And I always had a sense that there was just something intangible, some immaterial, intangible experience that was happening around us. I instinctually felt it. And I had other things that validated that. So other experiences.
So you felt this sense of there being something more to the experience. Is that correct?
Oh, absolutely. When I was 11 years old, I was sitting at the breakfast table that just happened to be beside a little window on our piece of property out in the middle of the woods in Florida. and I looked out the window, and there was an owl that was sitting on the tree staring at me. And I looked at the owl, and as I looked at it, I realized that it wasn't an owl, and I was transfixed.
And they often aren't owls. It's very true.
And it slowly became something else, showing itself to me. And the next thing you know, it's a couple of hours later, and I'm sitting at the table and with my bowl of cereal in front of me, undisturbed. Everything is in order. It's not like I, you know, had some kind of odd seizure. I was just sitting at the table. And I called my mom and had to tell her I missed the bus that day and explained to her, you know, that I didn't understand, that I had seen an owl and that I thought maybe I fell asleep at the table. But my cereal bowl was disturbed.
How much of a sense of missing time do you have? Do you notice many missing time experiences? Because a lot of us have a lot of them. I have lots of them. I had one day before yesterday, where suddenly 25 or 30 minutes are just gone. And there's no medical explanation for this. I've gone into it deeply with doctors, believe you me. And there's no explanation for it. Does it happen to you very often, do you think, or do you notice?
I have to tell you that as far as time goes, that I really struggle. I really struggle with it in general. This hasn't always been the case. When I look back on my life at missing time, they tended to happen around really incredible events like me seeing the owl and being transfixed. One morning, I was out very early in the morning. Nobody else was up. I was on a dirt road on my bike. A very large wolf just trotted out of the woods and stood in the middle of the road in front of me at a curve that would have been leading back to where I needed to go home. And it just stood there and stared at me. And again, I remember just being transfixed and having this feeling like that can't be a wolf. This isn't a wolf, but everything's fine. Everything's fine, you know? And then suddenly, I've got, you know, it's later in the morning and I'm on my bike. Cause I was standing there and I jumped back on my bike and I run home or rode home and told my mom that I saw a wolf, you know, that kind of thing. Though I have missing time around odd sightings of things.
Yeah. So you're somehow tangled up in this experience from an early age, apparently, in the close encounter experience. And it's not really the huge part of your life, but it's enough to where you maintain a sort of low level interest. I would assume that in being vetted for your job in the Defense Intelligence Agency that you didn't mention any of this stuff. Or did you?
I think that it came up. I don't think it was those kinds of questions. I don't think it would have come up, you know.
Yeah, that's right. They you know, they're not going that's to right. be asking you questions like that. That's true. Perhaps they should in the future. I don't know. But in yes. any case, so here you are. And let's now move on to a little closer to the present. And I get a call from my friend Alan Steinfeld saying that you have contacted him, or he's contacted you. I don't know quite how it worked. You can tell us.
Yeah.
And you're going to be doing this press conference. And I immediately thought to myself, that it will not work out. And I know why. And we'll get into the why of it in a little while. But tell us how, let's go back to the event, or prior to the event that happened that inspired you to do that. What was your life like in those months before that happened?
I was in complete rehabilitation at that time. In 2017, I had a health crisis that landed me in the hospital for a couple of months after being in the ICU. They thought that I had some very odd type or variant of Guillain-Barré syndrome that they hadn't seen. They couldn't pin it down in the laboratory. I presented as a spinal cord injury. You know, there were just all kinds of questions around what's happening in this body that's going on. And so That began, that illness, the critical part of it began in January of 2017. And so 2017 just literally became a convalescent year for me. I had many ups and downs, physically and emotionally. It was a difficult year. I was facing my own identity crisis. And wondering, what is it exactly? What gifts do I have that I can offer, it with a broken body? You know, like, how do I deal with a body that is falling apart around me, was, you know, kind of how it felt. And so, that's what 2017 was like. And in some of my better months, near the end of the year, I had begun going out socially a little bit. And so by the time that January 2018 came around, I was venturing out of the house now and then, you know, to spend time and to make friends, in an area that, I didn't know anyone. I was in Southern California, where I had been working with the Marine Corps, doing some intelligence at one of their schoolhouses, teaching intelligence. My health had interfered with that. And here I was now, sort of, you know, just found myself in the desert, on, you know, kind of a ship without a sail. And learning to be okay with that. That was really what 17 was all about, was learning to be okay with the new body and the new lifestyle, and finding those things about myself that I loved, that I felt I could share in some way, and trying to just be really super present in my healing and in my own kindness to myself in the process, you know, because
yes.
I was really always very hard on myself.
And free Dreamlanders, you're going to be very kind to us in a few minutes, because you're going to at last subscribe to unknowncountry.com and do whatever else we ask you to do during this break. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Anjali Schultz. Anjali, your Twitter feed, can you remind us of your Twitter feed and your upcoming website?
Yes. You can find me on Twitter at Anjali on Gaia. And the upcoming website is transcensionproject.com. And we hope to have that live soon. Thank you.
I apologize for having called you Anjali for so many months. Every time we've talked, I've always called you that. I recall Alan Steinfeld saying, you pronounce her name very strangely. And I thought, I wonder what's wrong. But now I know. And so please accept my apologies.
It's okay.
So we have now, you have gotten through a difficult year, 2017.
Yes.
And you find yourself out in the desert. What do you mean by that precisely?
Well, I mean it in just about every way that a person can mean it. I was like, I was in a place in my life of complete, vast openness to anything and everything that could come to me. I was not presumptive. I just wanted to experience, and I felt like if you think about life in the desert, I don't know how many people who are listening have ever lived in the desert, but it's one of the most remarkable landscapes. It'll surprise you. In its depth of life and richness and the tenacity of the creatures that live there to survive and how perfect they are for their environment. It's absolutely remarkable. And I started feeling like it was a perfect environment for me, that I fit in, that as part of my spiritual and my identity search, as far as like an identity role, like what do I do in this world now? I was just open and kind of baking in the sun, you know.
Yeah. And the Mojave is a very magical place. And of course, the Trinity site is in the Mojave Desert. There have been a lot of famous sightings and so forth in that desert. Not in that desert, but in another desert, it's where the Roswell incident took place. So deserts are strange places, and deserts are places that are in some ways haunted by a presence that's different from us. And that presence turned out to haunt you in the desert. You were a little girl. You saw something that marked you. What exactly happened? I've listened to the hypnosis you did with Barbara Lamb, and my conclusion is the same with any hypnosis that I've ever done or listened to or participated in any way. We don't know what it's about. We don't know, well, because you remember going aboard the craft and so forth. But we don't know what happened. But tell us what you do remember anyway.
Right. Now, Barbara and I were having a conversation about it. There's a little bit of a misunderstanding that from everyone that I only remembered the event after hypnosis or during hypnosis. And that is not correct. She and I had a very in-depth conversation about it, what I remembered. And so it was important to me that I explore that while I was under. Okay. And so there were many things that I was exploring while I was under hypnosis that were not being verbally shared with everyone because it wasn't necessary. And I ended up having contact with the beings in real time. Like they were, it wasn't, I was back inside the tunnel. It was, they were talking and they were there then. They were just, I was reliving it. And then they were, when they were sharing what I was sharing, that was happening in the real time. And it was remarkable to me. But what I do remember now and had remembered through meditation prior to Barbara, which only reaffirmed what I had been remembering, is that I was on board the craft. And there were lots of other small beings, humanoid beings that were very, very much like children. And I understood them to be children. There were also adults.
This is when you were a child. Yeah.
And I was okay. A child. Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
It turns out it was in 1976. And boy, there probably were 20, you know, maybe 20, 30 of these small children who were at, you know, various heights, but all around my size. And, you know, they were touching me and feeling me and pulling on my clothes and giggling. And we were all giggling together and they were beautiful, but none of them had hair and their skin wasn't, they would not have passed for human. And what I had discovered was that these were actually brothers and sisters of mine, that they had been using my mother's eggs and genetically modifying, and I was a successful modification. I could pass for human, and all these others were the ones that didn't.
How interesting. Of course, for someone outside of our experience, that seems like a completely fanciful story, but
it
not
does.
To someone who's inside the experience, because I've heard that story in various versions dozens of times, and most of them from the 1970s and early 80s, when this type of event was really very common among us. So
that's
I'm
right.
Not so willing to just dismiss it. And I also know Barbara Lamb quite well, and I know her skill and her level of professionalism. She knows what she's doing.
She does.
So, but that all of that said, I'm not going to go so far as to say this happened in the real world that we understand.
Right.
It happened all right, but whether or not it happened in a way that we finally absolutely understand is an entirely other and, in my opinion, unanswered question. And I'm sure that you or any other close encounter witness would agree with that.
That's right. There's something that's incredibly, you know, do I believe that the craft was physically there? Absolutely. I do. Yeah,
well, because you had other witnesses. Exactly.
That's right. And there were other people who also realized that they have no idea where I was during that time.
Right.
That I was unaccounted for. And that's important.
Right.
So I believe that I was taken aboard this craft. I don't understand inside. It isn't, it's almost, I don't even have words. I'm probably going to sound like a complete fool for people who know what this actually means, because I may be using words I don't understand, but it's like I was inside of another place, like another field of energy, another dimension.
Listen, you need to say no more. A lot of us, like me, are nodding our heads right now. We've been there and done that. That's not an uncommon experience. The sense of perceptual dislocation is very profound.
That's right. So here's this physical craft. Everybody can see. I go in it. I have no idea where I actually am.
Exactly. Well, that's very common and a very accurate way of describing the experience of being taken aboard a craft, because you suddenly, you might be aboard a craft, but this is a very complex experience. You could be in a different, you could be in a different universe and on a different planet in a different time. We just don't know. But one thing that is very clear, once we're there, we don't know what the devil's going on, and we're not necessarily going to be able to find out either. But we do know this. There's a baseline. Other people saw this there. You were gone. You came back. Your cereal was presumably fairly damp by then, and you couldn't explain it. Then later, many years later, Barbara comes along. And she's able to draw what memory you do possess out of you. So that's where we are. Now, what do we know as Close Encounter witnesses about Anjali at this point? We know that she's involved. More importantly, we know that they take an interest. And why do we know that? Because of the figure on the that looked like an owl and slowly turned into something else, that is a sign of presence, of awareness that many of us have experienced. Because once you see that, then you're on their list, no question about it. But whose list, and what does that mean? Those are things we can't answer. We don't know what they mean. Now, we're going to take another little break here, and when we come back, we're finally headed for that cave and beyond. And believe me, folks, there is a beyond that you do not expect. We'll be right back. UnknownCountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field. And when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system. It energizes the solar system. As you have things going into the sun, even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun. It will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age, in approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted, and this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change, in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to UnknownCountry.com right now. Click on the subscribe tab. Get started.
We're back with Anjali Schultz. I'm finally pronouncing her name correctly after all these months. And we have been talking about her connection to the experience, to our experience, which is very much like the connections of many other people. Most of us have connections very similar to hers. And I could read you probably 10 or 15 letters that discuss experiences very like the ones that Anjali has told us about. Now, at some point, you meet a man called Wayne. How did that happen?
I was having coffee, just sitting with a friend in a coffee shop in the morning on a Sunday.
And where was this?
In Southern California.
But not in the Mojave or in the Mojave? Or Joshua Tree? Oh, okay. If you don't want to say, that's fine.
Yes, I would rather not say because, you know, I have learned something about trusting the public with information right now.
You sure have. I know that people have been, as always, many of the UFO researchers are showing putting their that's best right. foot forward, and that's not necessarily a very good foot. So
now you know where the coffee shop is, but I have never disclosed that to anyone else.
Oh, okay. Well, we won't go there then.
That's right.
So you're having coffee with a friend.
That's right. So I'm having coffee with a friend who's about to head home, and I'm going to head home. And a couple walks into the coffee shop, and you know, we make eye contact just because I'm facing the door, and they have bright and open smiles on their faces. They're just very happy and lovely looking people. And they came over and sat with my friend and I in this communal sitting area that we were sitting in, and just began a conversation, just saying hi and, you know, all the subtle niceties. And as the conversation went on, we discussed his cancer and my illness. And he told me then that I had it's really interesting, Whitley, like thinking about this now. I don't think that I've ever really stopped and thought about it quite from this perspective, but I'm wondering if the beings were speaking to me that day, because he was talking to me about the burden of negative energy in my body from the places that I had worked and the energies that I had come in contact with, and that it had become a physical body burden on me. And that it was going to continue to make me ill, that I had to release this body burden. And I thought that was very enlightening for someone, you know. Wow, I just never thought about this. It's kind of remarkable, you know. I'm having an epiphany that perhaps they were already speaking to me through him. So anyway, so we talked about illness and, you know, choosing our path in life and trying, you know, to be positive forces in the world for good and to be uplifting. And he pivoted 100%, just pivoted and asked if, you know, what I thought about aliens. And
now that's an interesting thing that he would do that. Because do you have any more insight into his background than you did when we last spoke?
You know, not that I will talk about. I feel like any time that I say something, you know, it sparks a fervor in people, to try. And so I'm just so hesitant. But I, you know, I will tell you this, that that he is on his own journey, of course, you know, like all of us are, and we have touch yes. points. His and my journey are not the same necessarily. But I don't think he realizes how much we are intertwined, he and I. And unfortunately, because of how sour things went publicly in trying to locate him, you know, our relationship has become tenuous, and he's been very stressed. And so I very much respect his need for space and quiet and healing. And, you know, I want nothing but love for him and compassion from everyone for this man and his wife. And no, I don't think that physical disclosure is more important than his health. If it was, it would have happened despite it. And that's the nature of this, is that when you're dealing with positively oriented beings, they're not going to force against your will. This is all very much choice driven. This is an experience that we have all asked for. We have received it. And each moment, a moment is like about as long as a bell rings. That's about how long a moment is. You know, we have to be present. We have to be kind. And
I understand. And I think probably a lot of my listeners do too. Now, you're in a situation with him. He tells you about this tunnel that he's yes. dug. And there's all yes. kinds of things on the internet about the tunnel and where it is. And I can assure everyone who's sure they know where it is, you're not in the right place.
That's right.
And you go in.
Yes.
What happens in the tunnel?
Well, I actually, when we were on the way to the tunnel, when we were walking, that's when the contact really began for me. I was already receiving some really like intrusive images, okay? Meaning all of a sudden, I'm seeing a face that I wasn't seeing a moment ago, and it's not human, and it's saying hello to me. And I'll go, you know, which just threw my hands up to my head and said, "What the F is going on?" You know, that's the first time I said it. And Wayne and his friend looked at each other, the other male friend, and the male friend said, "She's there now. She's seeing it." And then we kept walking, and I said, "Seeing what?" And he was like, "You'll see. Let's just keep going, you know." So we get inside the tunnel, and this happened several times while we're on the way. And so I'm watching my footing. I'm keeping my feet, you know, my eyes are down a lot on the ground, just making sure that I don't stumble inside of this tunnel. I'm behind the two men, the women are behind me, and things are becoming more confusing, okay? And what I mean by confusing is I'm starting to get like this sense of a disorientation that I wasn't familiar with.
That's okay. Why I brought the whole issue of disorientation up a little while ago, because I knew we would get here shortly. So go ahead.
Yes. A very disoriented. in the sense of not that I'm falling over, you know, not that sort of disorientation, and not in the sense of I'm seeing the walls moving or having like some kind of visual hallucinations or anything like that. I'm very aware that I'm in this tunnel and that I'm in this physical location and who I'm with and where I, you know, what's happening. I'm 100% on board, but I'm feeling like something is I don't even know how to explain it.
There's
I'm
a
so
perceptual
sorry.
Disconnect that takes place at this point in many experiences, including my own.
Yes.
Yeah. And, and if you've had the experience, you know what we're talking about. If you haven't, you don't. And you can't, we can't explain it. It's unexplainable, but it is definitely part of this. When this begins to approach you, a lot of things happen. And, you know, I've gotten used to it over the years, and because I've had that happen many, many times. But in the first years, it was just so profoundly disorienting, and not in not as you say, in a way of the walls moving or anything like that. It's deeper disorientation than that.
That's right.
Yes.
Very well.
So now we are going to see somebody new. What happened next?
Well, so when we round the corner and I see them, there just wasn't even a moment of hesitation inside of me, Whitley. It was 100% acceptance and there were these underlying thoughts of, wow, I knew it. But also that was like such a small, it was like becoming such a small voice because I knew it, you know? So the revelation was becoming less of a revelation as I was moving towards them. And that was part of that perceptual thing that we were trying to talk about, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't know how to explain that feeling, except that, you know, from the moment of the initial revelation of seeing them to the moment that I'm standing beside them, it's less of a revelation to me. So I don't know how to explain that, except that I was having very extreme conscious communication. And I was not only hearing them and perceiving their images and all of the information that would come with it, but I was also aware of the conversation that was going on between them and Wayne. Which is remarkable.
In what sense?
We were all like in a stream, you know? I was aware of his responses to the beings, and I was aware of what the beings were communicating back to him. But I wasn't even a part of that conversation other than they were speaking about me, okay? And so if we think about that from an energetic standpoint, just perhaps on a consciousness level, evoking, you know, the intention for another consciousness, and they pull them in a way that they can become connected to that kind of communication, because it was quite a strong connection that we were all having at that moment.
There's a level of intimacy associated with that kind of consciousness, because the consciousness is not simply confined to the body, and it has a field, and the fields, depending on, I guess, the situation, it can be a couple of miles, but you certainly entered that field while you were walking into the tunnel began to see these images in your head. So you have been beautifully set up now, and we will get into the question of that setup in the third half hour. Something was happening here that I'm not so sure that Anjali entirely is aware of, but we've discussed it very briefly, and we'll discuss it more at length in the third half hour of the show. And this is, nothing here is really entirely what it seems, let me put it that way. And that is usually the case with this experience. So, free Dreamlanders, I would like to thank you for staying with us as long as you have. And remember, please, that this is the only place in the world where this conversation can take place. I have not been going down the road of, did it happen or didn't it happen? Is it true or is it not? Is she crazy or is it not? Was she on drugs or was she not? I don't care about any of that stuff. That's in another level of reality as far as I'm concerned. We're working in this level of reality on this show. And we're going to go a little deeper in just a moment. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for being with us.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.